One has to give credit to Harry Pace for documenting these two important spirituals that really are also symbolic and emblematic of the idea of racial uplift, but are culturally significant across the generations. These are two early recordings. These are two recordings that are obviously not the Fitz Jubilee Quartet recordings of 1909. 1910 by Victor Records. These, you know, are afterwards, but these represent two ensembles a singer and an ensemble who would really be lost to time. And it is wonderful that, in particular, that glorious voice, that glorious baritone voice of C. Carroll Clarke will be documented and able to be enjoyed 100 years later today in 2021. We arrive at William Grant Still, music director, arranger for Harry Pace's Black Swan Records, and the consummate voice of racial uplift and the iconography in music of the New Negro during the Harlem Renaissance. The music of William Grant Still encapsulated the pride of Black culture, of Black identity, in symphonic voicing that matched the affirmation of Blackness and the celebration of the New Negro in the murals of Aaron Douglas, the poems of Langston Hughes, Conte Cullen, Claude McKay, and Zora Neale Hurston. Still's Africa celebratory ballet, Saji, which we will hear an excerpt, epitomizes the essence of Black pride in the Harlem Renaissance, New Negro, and the young Pan-African movement of Marcus Garvey. Let us take a listen.
Go ahead!
This exceptional lost generation of Black artistic excellence emerging between 1918 and 1924, which found resonance and opportunity to be documented in recordings of the Black Swan Record Company of 1921 to 1924, did not die without leaving a mark. To the contrary, the artistic excellence of these performers and the gift of the young composer, William Grant Still, would inspire a torch passing to the next generation. Enter composer Adolphus Hailstork, celebrating his 80th birthday in 2021. Dr. Hailstork is the most renowned and performed Black composer of our time. He is, as William Grant Still was in the 1930s to 50s for our times. A student of Nadia Boulanger, David Diamond, and Victor Giannini, Adolphus Hailstork's sound world is a unique composite of American and African-American traditions in symphonic music. Perhaps one of the most important aspects of his music is the infusion of storytelling, an intention to have his music act as a story griot or messenger for Black history. Let's listen to a short suite of music that samples three works, Hercules, a tribute to the famous Black slave cook of President Washington, Zora, We Are Calling You, a tribute to the Harlem Renaissance writer, Zora Neale Hurston. And there's a third one, but I think we'll have to skip that one. But we will go instead and listen to what is really a tour de force of Dr. Hailstork's from his great cantata, Done Made My Vow with Text by President Barack Obama. It's a 2018 performance by the Lawrence University Choirs, Orchestra, and soloists under the baton of Stephen Sieg. Let's move forward.
Thank you. Dream. Obama, guilty of daring and having the courage and vision to become president of these United States of America. It is the fundamental belief that I am my brother's keeper, I am my sister's keeper, that makes this country work. It is what allows us to pursue our individual dreams and yet still come together as one American family. I am not talking about blind optimism. I am talking about something more substantial. It is the hope of slaves sitting around a fire singing freedom songs. The hope of immigrants setting out for distant shores. The audacity of hope. Hope in the face of difficulty. Hope in the face of uncertainty. The audacity of hope. In the end, that is God's gift to us, the bedrock of this nation. We affirm the greatness of our nation, not because of the height of our skyscrapers, or the power of our military, or the size of our economy. Our pride is based on a very simple premise, summed up in a declaration made over 200 years ago. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator by certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Hope is the bedrock of this nation, the belief that our destiny will not be written for us, but by us, by all those men and women who are not content to settle for the world as it is, who have the courage to remake the world as it should be, brick by brick, block by block. Together, ordinary people can do extraordinary things because we are not a collection of red and blue states. We are the United States of America. And in this moment, we are ready to believe again.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. I dream a world rich in Black stories where all will know
sweet freedom's way. Langston Hughes,
thank you. I'm available for questions.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Bill.
Yes, I'm available.
Okay, we have time for some questions here. Before we get to questions and our Q&A, I want to thank you for an amazing presentation, Bill. I've learned so much within this hour from you. Not only was it educational, it was entertaining. Thank you for that. I appreciate it. Amazing.
You're very welcome. Now, do we have any questions here?
Do we have any questions in the chat?
I have one.
Okay.
Hi, Bill.
Hi, Michael.
I want to take you back to something you said very early on. I'm really surprised that Harry Pace is not recording W.C. Handy or any of that music, because, I mean, they were business partners. They grew up together. I want you to speculate a little bit on why that was. I'm wondering if there is something about the talented 10th or racial uplift that was leading him towards classical music, which was seen as kind of the arbiter of fully evolved cultural at the time.
Yes, you're right. And I will actually open the mic to the grandson of W.C. Handy, Mr. Carlos Handy, who can speak to this more. We have talked quite a bit about this mystery. So Carlos, please, and I should just introduce you too. So Michael Svivak is the senior editor of San Francisco Classical Voice, the leading West Coast Time magazine for the performing arts, and also a historian that I've worked with. So please, Carlos, please.
All right, great. I'll preface my remarks by saying that through Bill, I was made aware of the documentaries or the NPR Radio Labs episodes, if you will, on Harry Pace. I'll be very honest. I was a little disappointed with the way they characterized my grandfather's influence, and it got me thinking, and I came to realize certain things that I had never thought before, and that maybe other I'm a physicist by day and in some sense trying to become a black music historian by night. So I'm learning things. But in the process of trying to better understand what was happening, like a ton of bricks, I realized that my grandfather was not perceived as among the talented 10th or someone that could contribute to that movement. And that really struck me. Because, you know, I grew up thinking of my grandfather as a very erudite, introspective individual, a very educated. And what I came to realize was that in reality, there was a dichotomy. E.B. Du Bois or W.E.B. Du Bois and Harry Pace and others of the Uplift the Race movement were very much into the standards set forth by white society, which means that you basically go into classical music. And the other reality was that my grandfather was actually a champion for the Afro-American folkloric traditions that we call the blues. So it's clear to me now that Harry Pace, through E.B. or W.E.B. Du Bois, they did not consider my grandfather as of their caliber, as a member of the, let's call it the super elite black society. And they wanted to distance themselves from him, which is, to me, an amazing statement that until now, through this vanishing of Harry Pace, I never would have thought of. So I think that there was a real dichotomy. There was an elite black society that wanted to forget about indigenous black culture, as embodied, if you will, by the blues. And my grandfather was the only champion of that at the time. And I think that was a real reason why they did not really, you know, reach out to him, if you will, and perform his music.
And I should chime in because I am featured in episodes 1 and 5 of the Radio Lab, as well as in the text piece for NPR, All Things Considered. Harry Pace did realize by the time, within the first 6 months, when his focus on recording light classical music, specifically Reveille Hughes, I sampled, a beautiful voice, Thank God for the Garden, an art song done at a women's social club soiree, a women's tea, so to speak, of that caliber. You know, it was part of this world of color, of class and color. But by the 6 months period, there were so few records sold, and Black Swan could have, with everything else going on, could have folded. It wasn't until someone said to him, now it's bizarre, because he's basing his company on the model of the runaway hit from 1920 of Crazy Blues by the very well-known in his time black jazz pianist and composer Perry Bradford for OK. I mean, Mamie Smith was before there was Bessie Smith, there was Mamie Smith, if you will. And that recording should have been the model, but it wasn't, interestingly enough, until it became clear that he needed to, he had to pivot. And once he did pivot and discovered the young Ethel Waters, a little bit more refined, kind of a song stylist who also did blues, he recorded her. And then the record company took off. He recorded her in Down Home Blues and Oh Daddy, neither of them being kind of down and dirty Bessie Smith style songs, but more blues that would be acceptable, I hate to go here, to the talented 10th, upper black elite soiree, during that time, where there were certain black neighborhoods and black individuals who had, fine homes and could have afternoon teas and events in the backyard. This is more the world of 1950s Lynx. The Lynx, this is part of that many decades beforehand. So, Michael, what's interesting, and complicated is that, yes, he recorded the blues, and the blues ended up being the financial bedrock, which should have been obvious, but it's conflicted.
Bill, would you allow me just one further remark? On the board of directors for Black Swan was W.E.B. Du Bois and a host of other, the devotees of the Uplift, the race movement. So it's clear that they regarded themselves superior to my grandfather and his emphasis on preserving and promoting authentic Southern black music, i.e. the blues. And, they thought that was uncouth and not part of their master plan. So it was a revulsion against Handy. And so I don't think he was brought into the fold, if you will, for that very reason.
But yet the counterpart of that or counterpoint to that is, isn't it interesting that it was the blues recordings of Ethel Waters first, then Kathy Crippen, Trixie Smith, and then about Alberta Hunter that anchored financially this label that was more about racial uplift. So there's a dichotomy, there's a clear dissonance going on. He wanted this more upscale class and color. I mean, he's coming from that, but his buying audience in Harlem and across the country is interested in this other thing. But the fact that he was the senior partner of Pace and Handy, I mean, this is basically W.C. Handy's music publishing business, the only black or colored music publishing business in the country, in the Tin Pan Alley at the turn of the century of New York, that he would not, wherever all the white artists were and doing really well, is really controversial and frankly, unfortunate. I think that was, there's obviously something that happened. And I know Carlos and I have talked about that.
Yeah, one more point, and you know, you tossed the nerve. I really believe that Pace, being as smart as he was, that he knew that the proper road to follow was popular music, i.e. the blues. But I think that he was in bed with the, you know, Uplift the Race movement and W.E.B. Du Bois and all that represented, and their involvement, if you will, in creating Black Swan, that he couldn't at first break away. That's why I'm really interested to know what the impact on W.E.B. Du Bois was when they were essentially forced, or Black Swan Records was forced to go into a more refined version of popular music. It's like a turning upside down, if you will, of the Uplift Erase philosophy that basically, if you will, only white music, if you will, i.e. classical music, was the standard that they had to live up to. So some, that's why I think there's some tension, eventually there's some tension, I have to believe, between W.E.B. Du Bois, you know, movement, Uplifting the Race, and what Black Swan was forced to get into. There had to be some tension there. Okay.
Sure, there was. And again, the dissonance and the irony is that after Ethel Waters' Down Home Blues and Oh Daddy became the financial foundation for Harry Pace and the Black Swan Records, he created, you know, in 1921-22, in the fall of 21-22, national tours that you would see in the late 50s, early 60s with Berry Gordy and the Motown and his Motown tours. So it's interesting, but that's the significance here too, to this point, is that even though Harry Pace was not all that he should have been, for Black Americans at the time, and as the first, really, I mean, he's not the very first. There's actually one ahead of him. In 1919, there was George Room up in Bedford, Massachusetts, very short-lived. He only pressed like 13 records, and it was only classical music. I mean, he was the first to record Florence Tell Cole Talbert. He recorded R. Nathaniel Dadd, etc. But the thing that's interesting is that, yeah, this is dissonance. I'm not quite, but you know, this is dissonance in the fact that he would have this major tour, which was only about the blues and only about pop songs. And then he would have other, you know, kind of vaudeville-ish kinds of, you know, comedy acts and, you know, intertwined is interesting. It's almost on some level, how do I say it? Schizophrenic, for lack of a better term. You know, there's this one
double thing, consciousness. Right.
Yeah, well, of course, literally.
I mean, it's funny that W. Du Bois would fall into that, you know, that condition, having anatomized it, you know?
Yeah, well, it was a double, and on a level, it was double consciousness by the fact that he had, I mean, his financial foundation is the blues. His market, his Black demographic record-buying market, is the blues, but yet he had this other thing. But that was also part of his, and you'll hear this in all of the six episodes on Radiolab, that was his downfall, in essence, is that, I mean, what part of his downfall was this sense of dissonance, the sense of also dishonesty, and the fact that by early 1924, he actually set the example for all of the leading white record labels of the era that there was a market for Black records, for Black artists. In other words, that Black people actually bought phonograph records, you know, and others like that kind of music. And therefore, and because of that, all of us, and he was having financial problems, these other labels like Columbia could offer Ethel Waters, who was a Black Swan artist, three times the salary she was getting from Harry Pace. Bessie Smith, who became the blues person, was signed by Columbia in 1924. You have Alberta Hunter going to Paramount, another large label. So it's interesting, it's important, the history that he establishes is significant for on a number of different levels. And most importantly, the takeaway is that it, if it weren't for Harry Pace and his Black Swan record companies, other the white record industry, which had this blinders on about recording Black artists doing Black music, that would never have happened had it not had Harry Pace not existed, so to speak. So it's very complicated and very complex, and that's why I think the what's interesting for a lot of people is this story that's being showcased through Radio Labs and NPR, because there's so much more to this. Cat is, I will say to you this without giving it away, so to speak, like in a movie, not giving it away. Harry Pace is the most significant African American business entrepreneur east of Tulsa. You had, during the same era, 1919, 1920, up until the destruction of Greenwood, you had Black millionaires coming from the Deep South, some probably from Atlanta, where W.E.B. Du Bois and where Harry Pace was. But Harry Pace went north in the Great Migration and landed in, from, well, essentially landed in New York. But he is the most important business entrepreneur outside of Tulsa. We know of him initially through Black Swan Records, but he also had established a very vital Black insurance company, life insurance company. And then he actually was like a, for lack of a better term, like a Microsoft and bought up all these other smaller companies. And by the time that Black Swan ended in 1924, he sold it to Paramount. And he, Harry Pace and others, his family moved to Chicago. He had one of the most significant Black life insurance companies in the country. So this cat is I mean, this cat, and there's more to it. And I said, I will not do it. This will be a spoiler alert. I won't tell you the rest of it. It's a fascinating story. You know, we're grateful. I mean, these records, by the way, now especially are impossible to get. Especially since the NPR and Radio Lab stories broke, they show up in auction and they are like ridiculous. You know, I'm grateful that I have the a decent collection. I don't know the total number of recordings that they made, but I do have a decent collection. The one kind of the holy grail for me on this is that he did have the sense to record the first recording of James Weldon Johnson's The Negro National Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing, is a Black Swan record. Extremely rare. I don't know why. I know it's at Yale. Yale University has a very significant collection of the Black Swan records. I believe Emory University, Atlanta. But as you're hearing, you know, these are in special collections. I mean, these are valued, but the opportunity to hear them, to talk about them, it is limited. And that's where I guess I come in. And that's why I've been, during the COVID-19 pandemic, doing these mini lectures that are uploaded to YouTube. So if you put in, go on YouTube and type in keywords, my name and Black Swan, you will hear more of what I have done.
Bill?
Yes.
I have a question in the chat from Cynthia. Are you there still?
I'm here.
Cynthia?
Yes. Can you, I had several questions, but I'll just do one because I'm sure we're limited on time. The question is about, I heard part of the NPR sessions on Pace, and I found them extraordinary and very well done. Now, I'm wondering if there's has been any speculation about his disappearance, whether there were some nefarious things, whether there might have been some jealousy, there might have been some internal problems, or that he might have just wanted to disappear and become just an anonymous person.
No, that's not the case. Actually, when you have a chance, go on to Radio Labs and listen to to episode 2 and 3. There's quite, it's a murder mystery in a different kind of way, not a murder. But the bottom line is what happens to Harry Pace is extraordinary. And this is a spoiler alert, so I'm giving it away. Harry Pace is throughout this, at the 5 episodes, called the Race Man. He is perhaps the most important protege of racial uplift as the protege of W.E.B. Du Bois. However, he's very passing, and he's able to navigate, even though he's a Black man, in certain circles as a white man. And, you know, he's part of this whole world, especially at that time in the 20s and 30s, where color and class were everything. The family you came from, the church you went to, you know, who was your father, what did he do, you know, that all of that mattered. So the bottom line is that he moved to Chicago after, I mean, he was just he could pivot. I mean, it was crazy. He was really successful at pivoting, but he moved to Chicago his wife was, I guess, fair, and their kids were fair. By 1930, in the 1930 census, you know, he was notated as Negro, but by 1940, he was notated, he had himself as white. But yet had Chicago's most important, or perhaps west of the, east of the Mississippi, the most important, biggest Black life insurance company in the country. I will just synthesize it for you, Cynthia. It's a case of an extraordinary case. It's probably the ultimate case of the Freddie Washington 1930s imitation of life movie. I believe that Harry Pace died prematurely in 1943 of a heart attack and was buried secretly because he and his wife had made a decision for their children, who they sent away to college, who were fair-skinned, who fell in love with white mates and wanted to marry. And so when their kids wanted to meet their parents, and their parents, although African-American, were living in an all-white neighborhood, but they could pass, that's what drove this bizarre. The more of the story is the very important part of the story, and I'll try not to be too long-winded, is simply that Harry Pace is in Chicago. Just by chance, he's the keynote speaker at John Johnson's high school graduation. John Johnson would be the publisher of Ebony Magazine. John Johnson is dark-skinned, Harry Pace could pass for white. John Johnson ends up being mentored by Harry Pace and has this idea to create Negro Digest, which would, by the time that Harry Pace would die unexpectedly in 1943, would become Ebony Magazine and would take off. But yet Harry Pace, during this time period, would not subscribe, even though he was downtown, he bought this major building, he was the president, CEO of this major Black life insurance company. He came to this time of his life where he, while in this mentoring of John Johnson, that he stopped subscribing to any Black newspapers, any Black anything. John Johnson would tell him what's going on in the Black neighborhood, because he was putting on this mask, if you will, that he needed for his children's sake and for his security. He was passing for white in a neighborhood that, if it was found out that he was Black, that there would be violence of it. So it's an extraordinary story. Cynthia, that's a little long-winded, but yeah, he didn't just disappear. He actually had quite a life afterwards. He dies unexpectedly in 1943. His wife, secretly has him buried in New York without a tombstone, or with a minor tombstone. That's also part of the Radio Labs episode. I think it's episode 4. This whole discovery of what, you know, became of Harry Pace's body, etc. But to Carlos Handy's point, which is interesting. So here we have the most important Black businessman to survive Tulsa and the destruction of Greenwood. He's fortunately not in Tulsa and Greenwood, so he didn't lose anything. He is probably the most successful Black business entrepreneur of his era.
Can I make one last comment, Bill?
Go ahead. I was just going to add something, but go ahead.
No, you go and finish your point.
No, I was just going to simply say it's interesting that he and his wife decided that they were going to be white for the sake of his kids and for their own overall safety, knowing full well his wife and him knew full well who he was and how significant he was. For his time, he is as significant as John Johnson would be, you know, or the other gentleman, I forget the guy's name, who founded Black Enterprise magazine. I mean, Harry Pace is really significant, but yet there's this bizarre change. And to Carlos Handy's point, what's interesting is that while Harry Pace was buried in utmost secrecy, and he was a senior partner of Pace and Handy, the music publishing business, which continues. When W.C. Handy died, he had thousands of people at his funeral. It was very public. So it's an interesting, it's bizarre. It's really what it is. So,
but you know what, you know what though? I think it's all interesting. And I guess the whole phenomenon of passing, that's a very common thing for those people that had the quote unquote, the air quotes, the gift to be able to pass. Now, the other part of that I was thinking about, as you well know, W.E.B. Du Bois's concept of the talented 10th was very elitist.
Yes.
And very color struck, and oftentimes into this serious respectability politics
yes.
frame of
yes.
mind.
Yes.
Hence, to go back to Mr. Handy's point, Zora Neale Hurston wasn't appreciated by Du Bois, and people who had certain talents were not lifted up like other people who were a part of the so-called talented 10th. And the talented 10th, to be quite honest, left a whole lot of people out and dismissed them. And that's also unfortunate.
Yes, it is. Yeah. And talented. There's a whole lot to say on this. I think there's a whole symposium around it. And I think that's what this Harry Pace, this kind of rediscovering of the Harry Pace and Black Swan Records story is so fascinating. You are talking about, most of us on here know about Freddie Washington, the actress Freddie Washington, and the famous movie Imitation of Life. Here you have a story of someone who is essentially not ashamed of his color, who is perhaps the biggest proponent of race and racial pride, all of a sudden just do a switch and then die from a heart attack, because actually he was an A-type personality. While he was doing Black Swan, he was also doing this insurance company. You know, and then he had a lot of things, a lot of irons in the fire, but I don't think he was taking care of his health. And, but, you know, just the way it all went. But yes, he was hugely significant, important protege of W.E.B. Du Bois. And part of that time period, for better or for worse, and I have some family history related to this, so I can speak to it. You know, it is all about color and class for many of the more upscale Black striving successful people at the turn of the end of the Great Migration, the period of 19, in fact, Du Bois was in Philadelphia, in West Philadelphia, and did this whole major project, writing, is a very famous project on a sociological project on 1916 West Philadelphia. West Philadelphia was all the well-to-do, color-conscious, class-oriented Black people that came from through the Great Migration. My parents, by extension, were in North Philadelphia. They were my color, and my mother wrote in her diary about the challenges of being from North Philadelphia and not being from the right family and not passing the paper brown bag. All of this is real, okay? And Pace is essentially emblematic of that. But it's a counterpoint and dissonance, because look, his label would have died the first year had he not recorded the blues. So it's but yet he didn't record any W.C. Handy. So let's, and all of these white artists, you know, Sophie Tucker, Marion Harris, original Dixieland jazz. I mean, St. Louis Blues is one of the most important songs in Tin Pan Alley, and successful and financially successful songs, you know, of that time period. I mean, it's outrageous. Frankly, it's outrageous how there is no recording that I can discover on Black Swan of the St. Louis Blues.
Justin, are you there? You can go with your question.
Unmute yourself.
My question.
Yes, go ahead, Justin.
I think you answered it. I just wanted to know what was the art in the last presentation done when they were singing and speaking. But also, I mean, it's exciting that the introduction they gave of Harry Pace, I really didn't know he existed. I think it's definitely looking forward to doing some more research on him and looking at this NPR you were referring to, just to get a better understanding of who he was as an entrepreneur.
Yeah, the NPR piece is shorter. It's like only 10 or 15 minutes. The Radio Labs showcases six different episodes. They range from 1 hour to anywhere from an hour and a half to, I think the shortest one might be 40 minutes. But in that particular series of episodes, you'll learn a lot more. Yeah, and about to your question about the last image that I presented, that was Dr. Adolphus Hailstork's cantata titled Done Made My Vow. It's for a large chorus orchestra and three soloists. And it was composed, I believe, in 1985. It's been very popular, done all across the country. Its time is now. If we can get past the long shadow of Donald Trump, I mean, I hate to go there, but you know, I mean, what you get out of that piece, especially towards the end in the section I showcase, it is, I mean, if we can have this moment that we're hoping to have or should have, of President Biden and Vice President Harris, I mean, I had already talked to a whole bunch of people about getting this to the Kennedy Center, you know, sometime either later this year or next year, but we don't know what's going to go on. We are in 2021, but it still feels like 2020, you know? So anyway. Yes, and oh, thank you, Michael. Yes, the version I showcased was the revised version of Done Made My Vow. The original had the text of Martin Luther King Jr. is very prophetic and very profound as well. Unfortunately, around the time of 2003-04, the King children decided to create barriers to the use of their father's words. So Dr. Hailstork pivoted came up with the idea to use the text, and got permission, legal permission to use the text of Barack Obama. So that's the version that is easiest to use, although the original version is quite dynamic. I don't know, you know, I don't understand those kids, but I'm out of that. But anyway, go ahead.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
Yes, Bill, this is Vita.
Yes, hi.
Hi, I understand that Dr. Hailstork was working on a composition in honor of George Floyd.
Yes.
Has that been completed? Is it available or what?
I can speak to all of that. Yes, it's a Requiem Cantata for in memory of George Floyd. The title of it's called A Knee on the Neck. It's a huge piece like the one you just saw, the last piece you saw. It's for a large orchestra, chorus, and three soloists. It is to be world premiered on March 26th and March 28th 2000 of next year by the National Philharmonic, which is a DC
not Washington, D.C. area orchestra. And we are waiting to hear where the next performances are. It has been, and I'll be, you know, this is a small group, so I can say this. It has been, I've chopped it. It is in the group of works that Asa-Pekka Salonen will be looking at. I'm connected with the symphony in terms of the artistic planners. So they have it, but we don't have an idea yet. I know that there's a possibility that it may go to Spoleto Festival, but all of that is yet to be seen. So yes, do they have the score? Yes, yes, they have the score.
They have the score?
Yeah, yeah. No, I had now all, yeah, Michael, yeah, I had to do it, yeah. Matt Spivey and Philippa have the score. I've been in touch with them. Frankly, it's a waiting game. Also, LA Phil has the score. Okay, so I've been on it. If people don't know, I've had the fortune since 2019 to be the marketing agent and publicist for Adolphus Hailstork. It's a great work. It's going to be a great work. I wish it was had been available and or had been composed earlier, but you know, everything, it was based on a text by a librettist who sent it to Dr. Hailstork. It's asking him to set it to music. Adolphus is just turned 80. He looks maybe 73,
yes,
74.
He does.
You know, but he's just turned 80 and he's got a lot that I'm not aware of even on his plate. Yes, it's come up before. I mean, where your hint going, it's come up before. Why wasn't it, you know, ready to be performed by the fall? I have to stay in my lane, if you will.
But is it possible that we could bring you back to actually screen that his work?
Oh, of course, absolutely. Yeah, in person, yes.
Yes.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I'm actually, just so you know, even though I'm out of town currently, but and I thought I was going to be back east with some Hailstork stuff in February. I'm actually going to be in the area, if not fully back in the area. I've just signed on to do the pre-concert lectures at San Francisco Symphony for the middle of February for Michael Morgan's concerts.
Oh, yes.
So that's, I think, February 16th through the 20th or something like that. So I'll be in town. I frequently, since 2014, have been part of the talk series of More Than a Month for San Francisco Public Library. And the Friends of San Francisco. So, I mean, that had, you know, even when I was not there, I mean, from 2013 to 2020, before the pandemic hit, I've always been at multiple libraries, and hopefully I can be at AMLO in person.
Well, yes, most definitely, definitely. Yeah. Well, are there any questions, Marco? We have any questions in the chat? Okay.
I will say one thing I should share to everybody that's here. So and especially for AMLO and the AMLO family and for Levon Chrisman, who is co-founders of Friends of Negro Spirituals, who a group that I am honored. And I will say, Levon, thank you for honoring me in 2012 as one of the Heritage Keepers Award recipients. I'm very grateful that I have the pictures and the plaque. I love that. So thank you for that. But what I want to say, simply put, is this. I have probably one of the more significant race and race consciousness focused early sound archives independently owned. What has shown up through the NPR piece and especially through Radiolab is that on the national radar, there are next to none African-American historians, scholars with this kind of collection. The kind of collection I have is generally only in university archives. Yale has the largest collection of Black Swan Records. Emory has, certainly the Schomburg has. But where I'm going with that is that I'm hopeful
in the future of aligning myself with an institution that will be interested in that. And I have, of course, obviously the background and the portable Victrola, which I have often used in real-time presentations. But I just want to put it out there because, and I say that, Vita, because there was great hope in 2014 with an association with an institution that had promised but never broke ground, and that's the Museum of Jazz and Art. Yes. I forget the gentleman's name, the architect who was behind that. He wanted my entire archive to be the foundation of the collection for the Museum of Jazz and Art. And they were supposed to be great ground, and I think in 2015, and they haven't, you know, they haven't yet. So that is over. In fact, I had actually written a grant with them as the end user for the Grammy Foundation for cataloging and then later for digitizing. So I'm putting it out there that as we are now in 2021, going into 2022, that I'm open and interested because
and we're most interested as well.
Great, wonderful.
Yes, most interested.
Great. Well, this is wonderful.
It is. Yes, this is. It was an amazing program, Bill, and I want to thank all our guests and a pleasure to have Mr. Handy to weigh in on the conversation. That this is pretty amazing too. So
yes, Carlos Handy is the great grandson of W.C. Handy, and that is. He is an we
grandson,
are
grandson, not great grandson.
I said grandson. I did say
yes.
Grandson.
Thank you, Mr. Handy. Thank you. We appreciate you weighing in on this event. Right. It's a pleasure.
Likewise. Thank you.
Okay, wonderful. Well, thank you all for being here. Please take a at your leisure, check out the Radio Labs episodes. There are 6 episodes. All of this launched, I think, the end of June through around July 4th, the NPR piece is there. That's a shorter piece. You will hear me in episodes 1 and 5. I did almost 3 hours worth of contextualized conversation. I had hoped that they would use more, but what is good for all of us is that some of what I've talked about today was actually used or was talked about for them to use, but I at the time I was doing that with them, I didn't realize there were 40 other people also involved in the project. It's a fabulous story. It's an important story. Harry Pace is. It is sad that what ended up happening, this disappearance of someone so vital. Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
May I make a remark, Bill?
Go ahead.
I was disappointed with the Harry Pace thing because they interviewed the grandchildren of Pace, but they didn't interview any of Handy's progeny. So after convincing them that it was in their best interest to do so, they promised to interview me next week. So I think some of the issues I brought up today, I will hopefully have an opportunity to convey to them as well. And so I look forward to that experience.
Yeah. No, and Handy, we have to all understand, and to Carlos's point, W.C. Handy is foundational to everything, the idea and the idea and the iconography and the sound of Black music at the dawn of the 20th century through the early period of recorded sound. And the irony, as I showed in that picture, St. Louis Blues is a Pace and Handy music publishing company, product. It just seems to me, I would love to know, be a fly on a wall, so to speak, to see what ended up happening, what the decision was there. I should share with you, Vita, and Carlos has not shared it. Carlos is the president and CEO of Handy and Handy Brothers Company. Oh. He has an incredible document of the correspondence between W.C. Handy and Pace
that he is working on digitizing. I believe that somewhere in all that correspondence, we will have more discovery of some of the missing pieces.
Yes.
So I just want to share that. And I know that AMLO probably would love to be, you know, part of that larger thing.
Oh, most definitely. We'd like to bring Mr. Handy to participate in one of our programs as well.
That'd be very nice.
Yes, I'm extending that invitation amongst all these people, so you can't turn me down, Mr. Handy.
Well, you're such a lovely lady, it's very hard to turn you down. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes. So, well, great. Well, thank you, everyone. If there's anything else, please feel free to ask. If not, you can certainly, if you don't have my email, I'll give it to you. It's bdoggett55@gmail.com. I'll repeat that, bdoggett55@gmail.com. And then if you want to explore more of my contextualized Black Swan recordings on YouTube, simply put in the word Black Swan and Bill Doggett, and they should come up. There are other recordings as well that I've given, a contextualized history. And I'm unique on YouTube in that way. These historic recordings generally are showcased by white collectors who simply put the record on, play it, maybe use historic photos as kind of an overlay, but they're never talked, the records and the significance of them are never talked about. So I'm grateful. So I've kind of set hopefully a new standard. Yes.
Thank you, Bill. This has been a pleasure. And of course, Mr. Handy, it's a pleasure to meet you. And I want to thank the A-Team, the AMLO team, because without them, I couldn't produce these sort of programs. It was a wonderful day. I want to thank everyone for taking the opportunity out of their busy day and chime into this event and share all this great knowledge that Bill has presented to us. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful, safe weekend, and I hope to see you all soon.
Thank you. All right. Bye-bye.
Bye. Yeah, I shouldn't. Leave me.